Let's try that one again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's great to welcome you to worship here at First Presbyterian Church. We love having you with us today. Before we share our love and greetings, let's center our hearts in worship today as we turn our attention to our prelude. Jeremy, you on. That's okay. Thank you, Jeremy. It is so good to have you in God's house today. I'd like to make sure that you've greeted the folks around you, so let's stand and introduce ourselves to one another in Christ's love. As you make your way back to the pew in which you're seated, we hope that you'll take the Ritual of Friendship pad if it's located near you. Please sign that and pass it down. We'd love everybody to have an opportunity to let us know they were here today. As you look around today, we're worshiping here, and in a few minutes, there'll be worship at Camp Cedarkirk. This is our church retreat weekend, so about 40 folks were down at Cedarkirk yesterday for a wonderful day, and many of them stayed over. A few of us came back for worship today here, but Reverend Sarah's down there. I'll be preaching with the retreat group, and they'll be going till about 3 this afternoon with activities at Cedarkirk, so pray for their safe return, but they're having a wonderful time at our church camp and conference center. Looking in here, oh goodness, I'm going to have to start writing better for myself. Our friends at Hope Presbyterian Church were our soup kitchen hosts yesterday. When I looked at the book this morning, it said they served 62 hungry people. Shepherd's pie was their menu yesterday and everything that went with it, and sounds like they had a wonderful time. And of course, they had plenty of seconds for folks. Looking at the calendar, we've got a couple open dates in May now on the soup kitchen, and then our June, July dates are open. So if you've been thinking about volunteering to help with that, the summer months are coming, and sometimes the volunteer base shifts a little bit. We've had a wonderful year feeding hungry people, and again, because of the place we provide, the generosity of our friends in the community, they're providing some funding, and then the volunteers at Hope Presbyterian, 62 people in Winter Haven did not go hungry last night, so that's a real celebration. Upcoming events, just keep your calendar marked. Holy Week is just around the corner. We will have our Maundy Thursday dinner and then the Maundy Thursday service with communion and tenebrae, the service of darkness. On Good Friday, the chapel is always open from noon to 3 for private meditation. Easter Sunday, the community sunrise service will be at Martin Luther King Park, and we're involved in that as we have been for decades. That's at 6:30 in the morning, and then worship here, 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock, the Easter breakfast, and also the Easter egg hunt at 10:30. So we hope you'll plan to join us as we move into a very exciting time. Even though Jeremy and I pored over the bulletin, we overlooked one thing for this week. We have not been singing the doxology during Lent, but we've been singing hymn 726, the summons, verse 5. That'll be projected on the screen. So in place of the doxology, we will sing the summons. And so when that comes up, I just wanted to note that for you. Talking about singing, Khalees Weber and Jeremy Rath are with us today. Let's thank them for providing music for us. Thank you so much. And right after worship, there's going to be a luncheon. Our Stephen ministers are the hosts for our luncheon today. It's soup, salads, and breads. It'll be down in McLeod Hall. It's a great opportunity to catch up with these folks that you worship with. We don't take reservations, and we don't accept payment for that. So you're welcome to come down. I've been doing some things trying to stay away from sugar, so I know that there is a keto-friendly cauliflower soup down there, but there's only like 10 servings, so the first 10 of you keto folks that get down there get that. The other soups are also incredible as I've looked at the selection. So please come down, just spend a little time around the table. Our Stephen ministers are so glad to host that. They've put some information on the table about Stephen Ministry so you know who they are and what they do in the church. And we hope you just come have a great time of fellowship after this. It's great to have all of you with us today, joining us virtually and in-house. Let us now continue in our worship of God. Friends, please join me in the call to worship that you find in our bulletin today. Clap your hands, all people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. God reigns over the nations. God sits on a holy throne. Since God is our King, we sing praises with a psalm as we worship God. Please join me, if you will, as we turn in our hymn books to hymn 385. Stand if you're physically able. Let's join together in All People That on Earth Do Dwell.
All people.
Please be seated. We're part of the Reformed tradition, and our worship service is based on the call of the prophet Isaiah. When Isaiah goes, he comes to the temple and he's called by God, and he praises God, and then immediately he's confronted with the grandeur of God. And Isaiah falls before God and says, "I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live amongst a people of unclean lips. Woe is me." So in our worship service, we start with praise. But when we admire God in God's fullness, we realize that we are not perfect. We are creatures. We are in need of confession and forgiveness. So we print a prayer of confession. There's a corporate prayer, a prayer that we pray together. There's a time for silent individual confession. And once we have confessed our sins, we're in a position to be cleansed as Isaiah was, and to hear that our sins are forgiven. So let's join together in that holy drama as we turn in our bulletins to the corporate prayer of confession. Let us join together, telling God that for which we are sorry. Let us pray. God, our Creator and King, we confess that sometimes our lives are so restless and busy that we don't take the time to reach out to you, knowing how good you are. While we thank you for our work, our hobbies, and our gifts used in volunteer service, we often let these very activities rob us of the precious time we could spend conversing with you in prayer. Forgive us for often starting the day without pausing to praise you for your blessings. Forgive us for the times when we have failed to stop to speak to you about our own concerns or with the needs of another in mind. Forgive us if we have ended our days without telling you about our joys or sorrows, or sharing that precious time of prayerful reflection. Speak to us and call us to speak to you as the one who makes our lives worthwhile and possible, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. As we lift our hearts and our sounds to you, God, we thank you for hearing our prayers. Amen. When Isaiah had confessed his sins, then all of a sudden, one of the flying creatures that attended the throne of God took a burning coal from the altar and flew to him and touched his lips and made him clean. And then, cleansed, Isaiah said, "Send me, Lord." And he was sent out to proclaim the good news. If you've confessed your sins today, be prepared to hear that through the work of God in Jesus Christ, your sins, my sins, are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Today's an exciting day in the church, and it's an exciting day for one of the families in the church, as today, Emily and Logan Lamb are going to bring their little daughter Sadie for the sacrament of baptism. So I'm going to invite the family to come down if they will. Friends, listen to the good news as it comes to us in the gospel according to Mark. They were bringing little children to Jesus that Jesus might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child shall not enter it." And Jesus took the children in his arms, and he blessed them, and he laid his hands upon them. Dearly beloved, the sacrament of baptism is the word of God made visible as ordained by our Lord Jesus Christ. Baptism is to be understood as a sign of God's power and mercy in cleansing us of our sin, and as a means whereby we are identified with Christ in his death and resurrection. Furthermore, baptism represents the outpouring of the Holy Spirit into the lives of God's people. It is the sign of our engrafting into Christ and our entrance into the church. The baptism of children and infants has particular significance for us because it reminds us this is a sacrament of God's grace and love. It illustrates that long before a child is conscious of God or confesses God, God has chosen this child as God's own. The sacrament of baptism declares publicly that this child has been claimed by God and engrafted into the body of Christ, the church. You see, our own children belong to the household and the family of God. In this sacrament, we're called also to see ourselves as helpless children whom God has created, sustained, loved, and cared for. We see in baptism that the journey in faith is a lifetime journey. Today, you're going to hear these parents proclaim that they will bring their child up to love and to serve God. You, the members of this congregation, along with this family, will also be asked to pledge that you will help this child understand the nature of the church through fellowship, love, and belonging. Logan and Emily, I ask you now, is Jesus Christ your Lord and your Savior?
Yes.
Do you trust in him?
Yes.
Do you intend your daughter to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love?
Yes.
Friends, let us bow before God in prayer. Most merciful and loving Father, we thank you for the church of your dear Son, for the ministry of the words, and for the sacrament of grace. We praise you that you've given us such gracious promises concerning our own children, that in your mercy you call them to you, marking them with this sacrament as a singular token and pledge of your love. Set apart now this water from a common to a sacred use. Grant that what we do here on earth may be confirmed in heaven. In humble faith, we now present you this child. We ask you to receive her, fill her with your Holy Spirit, keep her forever as your own, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. I ask you now, what is the Christian name of your daughter?
Sadie Ann.
Sadie Ann, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. May God's Spirit dwell in you richly from this time forth. Amen. Friends, this child is now received into Christ's church. Do you, the members of this congregation and this family, on behalf of the whole church of Jesus Christ, undertake with these parents the Christian nurture of their child, so that in due time she may confess her faith in Jesus Christ, as Lord and Savior? And will you endeavor by your example and fellowship to strengthen her family ties with the household and the family of God? If so, will you answer, we do. I want to present a couple things to you, and as I told you, I did not hear one grandfather well when he told me your baby's name, so I will correct this certificate this week, and it'll be Sadie Ann. And then, Miles, you probably have a cross that looks a lot like this at your house, because we gave one to you a few years ago at your baptism. And so you can help Sadie know that this cross came on the day that I put water on her head. This cross came from our whole church because our Honduras mission teams, of which your granddad John has been on several, we purchase these crosses when we're in Honduras and we bring them back. Now, if you're a little bit closer, you can tell that it says Jesus. We give these as our baptismal cross, and we just wait for the day that the child said, "Tell me the story of this Jesus cross." And it's the day that all of us said that we would do everything that we could in our prayers and in our actions to show you the love of Jesus Christ. So I'm going to give those to you all. And I've been promised that this one might go with me for a couple minutes. So friends, it's a pleasure now to introduce to you the newest member of the Church of Jesus Christ. Are we happy? Okay, good. This is Sadie Ann Lamb, a child of the covenant. Yeah, Sadie, your family just got a whole lot bigger here. And there's some tall people and some small people. And a whole lot of people that would just love to have an opportunity to tell you what it is to know that you're a child of God and to spend your time loving and serving our God. So little Sadie,
so
These are your new brothers and sisters in Jesus, and they're going to have a chance to watch you grow. Oh, I'm sorry, this side needs to see her too. Yeah. And again, her big brother's going to tell her what he saw happen here today. Mom and dad and grandparents will continue to let her know how much she is loved by the body of Christ. So Sadie, thanks for reminding us what I tell people, especially at Christmas. When God decided to come into the world and claim us, rather than coming as a king and demanding our allegiance, God came as a little baby to love us back. There's a kick. Oh, and you know these folks. There we go. Wonderful. Thank you for letting us be a part of your lives. Y'all can be seated. I left my bulletin up top. It does say time with younger disciples next. Is that right? This time I'd like to invite any young people with us to come down and join me down front for our time with younger disciples. There we go. Want to bring Mom with us too? We'll just come here to the front pew. I don't know that I can get anybody else to come, so let's just go sit right over here, okay? So Miles, you got to see us do a baptism here. And here in church, I want you to look around and see if you can see any candles today. Do you see any candles that are burning in here?
Yes.
You do? Where? Okay. I see a couple of them right there. Do we see any more?
Yes, all the way over there.
All the way over there.
Lots.
A lot of candles, that's right. That's called our Lenten calendar. Does that look like a calendar or does it look like something else?
It looks like something else.
You're right. It's a strange calendar, but we're going to get a little closer in a minute, and I'm going to need your help with something. This Lenten calendar, every week for 6 weeks, we light all those candles that look like a cross when we come to church. And that helps us count down towards a big thing.
I remember this church.
You remember this church? That's right. Say, you live up in Gainesville, I think. But this is, you do. But this is a place that you come when you're in Winter Haven. Well, let me show you something. Are you reading yet? Not yet. Okay. That says fifth Sunday in Lent. So for those of us that read, that tells us that we're 5 Sundays getting closer to Easter. But those candles over there, we don't even have to read. They can help us because there are 6 candles that we light every Sunday, and then we put out a candle for every Sunday that gets us closer towards the celebration of Easter. So I need your help today, and Mom can come with you. I need you to put out 5 candles. Could you do that for me?
Yeah.
Okay, let's come over here and get our candle snuffer. Why don't we put Sadie's cross right here, and we'll come back because you're going to need your hands. And what we're going to do on this is we're going to put this over the top and count to 3. So do you want to hold this with both hands? And I'll help you on the first one. That's going to be our first candle. Say 1, 2, 3. It's out. Now can you do that next one? 1, 2, 3. Got it. Let's pick it up and see. Good. We'll do that one. This will be our 3rd candle. 1, 2, 3. Okay, now we have to put out 2 more. Which other 2 do you want to put out? Okay, and let's reach your hands down here a little bit more. That'll give you a little higher. Okay, we're going to do that one. 1, 2, 3. Okay, and what's the last one you want to put out? That one. Perfect. 1, 2, 3. Great job. Now, there's 1 candle left there. Now, that reminds... What's that?
The high one.
That's the high one. That's why we left that one. That's right. And next week when we come, We're going to put that candle out, and then all the Lenten candles will be done. And that means the next time we come to church will be Easter Sunday. So this helps us count down. And by you coming up today, you've shown everybody here that we have only one more Sunday, which is called Palm Sunday, until we get to celebrate Easter. So that's pretty exciting. So that's what we do when we come. Also, I'm wearing purple today, and the candles are purple, and there are other things that are purple in here. That reminds us that we're preparing for Easter. So some pretty exciting things going on. So thank you for helping today. Without you, we wouldn't have been able to mark our calendar. So can we all fold our hands and you all join us and bow our heads and let's talk to God in prayer. God, it is a wonderful day. It's a day of listening to your word. It's a day of celebrating your love through baptism. It's a day of reminding ourselves that every single Sunday now gets us closer to Easter, when we celebrate your love for us in Jesus Christ. I thank you for allowing us to count down the days and spend this time together. And I thank you for our younger disciples who help us in that task. Now bless us as we go through the rest of Lent in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for coming down and helping me. Now you can go back over and we'll take Sadie her cross, okay? Another thing that we do in the Reformed tradition is we gather for worship because there are many things that we do better together than we do on our own. Part of that is in our music, because when we're in the midst of people and led by incredibly talented singers, our songs just seem to lift a little quicker to God. Part of it is that we share our gifts, because the gifts that we give together can do so much more than any of us individually in the kingdom. So at this time, we pause and let's bring God's tithe and our offerings.
Sempiternam.
pray. Wonderful God, you have showered blessings down upon us in our lives, and we joyfully receive them. We also bring a portion of those material gifts and our pledges of service and self, and we offer them up for use in the world through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. Friends, let's now continue in a season of prayer as we turn to God with the prayer of God's people. Wonderful God, as we gather here before you today, we thank you for the opportunity to gather. As we come into this home freely this day, we thank you for all those in our past who have provided the freedom that we have to assemble, who have maintained that freedom for us through our Constitution and allowed us to gather to worship you. We thank you for the founders, and we thank you for the defenders of our national institutions that have provided this freedom. We thank you for those who have served in the military. We thank you for those who even serve and protect now in our community. God, we thank you for the ability to gather this day. In our day and time, God, we also thank you for virtual abilities to gather. We thank you that the technology exists that lets us to connect with one another so that on this Lord's Day, we can still be together with folks who could not gather with us physically. We ask you to watch over those who may be traveling and joining us virtually. We ask you to watch over those who may be working at this time to provide for our comfort, care, and safety. We ask you to be with those who are confined to hospitals and homes and nursing centers, those who are not well enough to join with us. We also pray for those who may be incarcerated today and not free and able to join us, except virtually. God, we ask you to be with all who assemble and join with us today. Together, we lift our prayers. We thank you for this nation in which we live, and we pray for our leaders. We thank you for this world that you created, and we pray for leaders worldwide. God, we thank you that you created us and placed us in this beautiful place, and that you've given us the resources that we need for life. We ask you to help us to be responsible with those resources. Help us to be generous with those resources. Help us, God, to be good stewards of what you have provided. God, while we thank you for the things that we have, we also thank you for the people who surround us. We know that you made us to be in community, and we praise you for those people who are a part of our family and our family of faith. We thank you for our friends and co-workers. We thank you for our neighbors and those who join us in this community. God, we thank you that you've given us the beauty that we find in relationships and that you continue to bless us in those relationships. God, as we gather here today, we lift up our loved ones and friends. We pray for those with special needs now. We pray for those with physical needs. We pray for those who are suffering mentally and emotionally. We pray for people who are having difficulty in their relationships. We pray for those who are seeking employment. We pray for those who are having difficulty in adjusting to retirement. We pray for those who long for retirement but yet can't quite afford it. God, as we think about the people around us, we do pause in this time to lift up those important individuals to us, and we ask you to hear our silent prayers for them. God, on this day of resurrection, we thank you for the saving grace of Jesus Christ and the difference that it's made in our lives. On this day of a baptism, we thank you that your promises are extended not only to us, but to our children. And we thank you that you call us your chosen, and that you bring us in as beloved children, as claimed and redeemed ones, through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who died for us, who rose for us, who reigns in power over us, who prays for us, and who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, our scripture lessons for us today come to us in two gospel readings. I invite you to turn in the Bible that you may have brought from home or the Bible that you'll find in the pew, or direct your attention to the screen. Our first reading is from Luke chapter 6. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version, beginning with verse 12. Listen now for God's word to us. Now during those days, Jesus went up the mountain to pray, and he spent the night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples, and he chose 12 of them, whom he also named apostles: Simon, whom he named Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, the son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who was called the Zealot, and Judas, the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. Turning to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 10, beginning with verse 1, we find these words: Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you'll indulge me today, I want to start today's sermon with a little history lesson and a short exploration of the Middle Eastern culture around the time of the public ministry of Jesus. Now, to help us get the details correct, I want you to listen to two definitions from the Interpreter's Dictionary of the Bible. The first term that we're going to define is tax collector. In New Testament times, the Roman officialdom in Palestine had direct responsibility for collecting regular taxes, such as poll and land taxes. The collection of tolls from those transporting property, including slaves, by land or sea, was still, however, farmed out to private contractors. The latter paid a stipulated sum in advance for the right to collect the tolls in a certain locality, and then tried to make a profit on the transaction. Apparently, the Jew Zacchaeus in Luke chapter 19, where he's called the chief tax collector, had amassed his wealth by farming the tolls in the region of Jericho. Both the Roman officials and the tax farmers employed Jewish underlings to do the actual collecting. Now, tax officers are never popular, even in free lands, but the Palestinian tax collectors were an especially degraded and despised lot. At the beginning of the Christian era, the Jews of Palestine were not reconciled to Roman domination. They regarded themselves as an oppressed people under military occupation, and they looked forward to the liberation in not a very distant future. The harshness of the procurators aggravated their resentment. Messianic and revolutionary movements seethed undercover and at times boiled into the open. The extremist bluntly asserted that any act of submission to Caesar, such as paying a tax, was treason to God. The more responsible leaders did not go that far, yet they looked on the taxes and the tolls as a tribute exacted by a foreign conqueror, not as a legitimate requirement for the maintenance of social order. Besides, the sums wrung from them were often excessive to fatten the purses of the Roman officers or swell the profits of the tax farmers. The Jews who for pay participated in these operations were therefore regarded as doubly base and despicable. They had sold their services to the foreign oppressor as against their own people, and they were engaged in literal robbery. For they were helping their principals to suppress the public, and no doubt part of what they collected stuck to their own fingers. The rabbinic sources repeatedly bracket tax collectors with robbers. Tax collectors and their families were disqualified from holding communal office and even from giving testimony in a Jewish court. Tax collectors. Now for the definition of zealot. A term currently and particularly used to designate the more radical and warlike Jewish rebels against foreign, especially Roman, rule, but actually a term of much broader meaning. The word occurs in Luke chapter 6 and Acts chapter 1 as a designation of one of the disciples of Jesus called Simon the Zealot, to distinguish him from Simon Peter. The Aramaic form of the name, Kaana, has been preserved in Simon the Canaanean, which is found in Matthew 10 and Mark 3. The Hebrew root lying behind the Aramaic means to be jealous. The zealot gave himself over to God to be an agent of God's righteous wrath and judgment against idolatry, apostasy, and any transgression of the law which excited God's jealousy. Quote, jealousy and zeal both have the same Hebrew root. Simon the Zealot, before becoming a disciple of Jesus, had probably been a member of some zealot-like group in the Phineas Maccabean tradition of zeal for the law. There are indications that a multiplicity of such groups were active in Palestine during the first century AD, and that these groups constituted an important part of the hardcore national resistance to Rome. As Jesus grew to be a man, and as he was walking the earth in Palestine in the first century AD, the Roman government occupied what you and I now call the Holy Land. The Jewish people were not pleased that their long-awaited promised land was controlled by a foreign government. They were not pleased that the Romans demanded taxes from their subjects, and they were not pleased that some Jews actually sympathized with the Romans and served as tax collectors. And in doing so, they lined their own pockets through extortion and robbery. And during the time of Jesus' ministry, there were some militant Jews, people who had dedicated their lives to overthrowing the Roman oppressors. They were religious zealots. They were sworn enemies of Rome, the Romans, and anybody who would choose to work for them. And as Jesus was gathering 12 people to follow him, to share his ministry closely with 12, as he called them apostles, to ultimately become the foundation for his church, Jesus chose 4 fishermen, a couple of people with Greek-sounding names, and a few others, including 1, a tax collector, and 2, a zealot. Jesus chose a tax collector named Matthew. We talked about him a few weeks ago, but as a refresher, this is an image that my grandmother shared with me as a child from a book called Jesus Loved Them. And then from the film series, The Chosen, many of you are familiar with this person as Matthew. Jesus also chose as one of the 12 a zealot named Simon. Again, from the book Jesus Loved Them, he has kind of a sinister look to him, or at least as a 3, 4, 5-year-old, I always thought that. And in the Chosen Bible study video, not sinister, but actually menacing. This is Simon the Zealot, referred to as Simon Z to Chosen fans. You see, these two men are identified in the list of disciples, apostles, with a specific modifier for each of them. Matthew is called Matthew, quote, the tax collector. And Simon is Simon the Zealot. So it makes me wonder, what was Jesus thinking? As he set out to usher in the kingdom of God and to build his church, what was Jesus thinking when he called a zealot and a tax collector and made them a part of the inner circle of the 12 disciples or apostles? I think that's a great question for us to consider as the church of Jesus Christ. You see, we belong as followers of Jesus to the church, the ekklesia. That's the Greek word for church in the New Testament, ekklesia, from which we get the term ecclesiastical, relating to churchy stuff. Ekklesia literally means the gathering. And two of the building blocks that Jesus chose for his church, this gathering of followers, were sworn enemies of each other. He called a tax collector and he called a zealot. You see, it appears that the early church was clearly not united around politics. That's part of the history lesson for us today. Now, I don't know if you're a fan of history, but some of us are, and we seem to study history in part to inform our present lives. You see, the Church of Jesus Christ in this day and time is still the ecclesia. It's still the gathering of people called to follow Jesus. And if we look around our particular church today, if we think about this gathering of people called First Presbyterian Church of Winter Haven, we see that we're a fairly diverse group of people. Now, it's understandable because we live in a politically divided nation and our culture is diverse. And I think we seem to realize in the church that it isn't our religion or our allegiance to any particular political party or group. It isn't any occupation that binds us together. It isn't our following any particular sports team or hobby or special interest that unites us as a church. Instead, like one particular zealot and one specific tax collector, we're united in mission and ministry as we follow the same Lord Jesus Christ as our God. And our little history lesson today, rather than having to go back two millennia to get our lesson, how about going back in time a couple centuries? The American experiment was less than 100 years old when our nation was literally coming apart at the seams. What many thought was a Christian nation at its founding was bitterly divided within the first 100 years, and a civil war was raging. Its leader, Abraham Lincoln, was a person of faith, if not a member of any particular church. You see, along with that picture book, Jesus Loved Them, that I got from my grandmother, I have another book in my library that also came from my grandmother's bookcase. It's called Lincoln's Devotional. In the preface to that book, Lincoln biographer Carl Sandburg highlights how the family Bible was the first book that would have been available to a young Lincoln, and how Lincoln's writings and speeches are steeped in biblical phrases. Well, in another book that I didn't get from grandmother, that I bought for myself, published in 1998, called Herndon's Informants, the humility of Abraham Lincoln's journey of faith is captured in some stories that were collected in the years after Lincoln's death by Lincoln's law partner, William Herndon. Herndon's Informants, it's called. Now, there is one note in this book, 2 pages out of the 800 pages, that in 1886, a man named Joshua Speed sent this account to Mr. Herndon. "The last interview but one I had with the president," he wrote, "was about 10 days previous to his last inauguration. Visitors were coming and going to the president with their various complaints and grievances from morning till night with almost as much regularity as the ebb and the flow of the tide. In the room when I entered, I observed two ladies in humble attire sitting across the fireplace from where the president sat, modestly waiting their turn. One after another came and went, each of them bent on their own business, some satisfied, others grumbling. The hour had now come to close the door to all visitors. No one was left in the room except myself, the two women, and the president. With rather a peevish and fretful air, he turned to them and said, "Well, ladies, what can I do for you?" They both commenced to speak at once. From what they said, he soon learned that one was the wife and the other a mother of two men in prison for resisting the draft in western Pennsylvania. "Stop," said he. "Don't say any more. Give me your petition." The old lady responded, "Mr. Lincoln, we've got no petition. We couldn't write one and had no money to pay for writing one. I thought it best to come and see you." "Oh," said he, "don't say anything more. I understand your cases." He rang his bell and ordered one of the messengers to tell General Dana to bring him the names of all the men in prison for resisting the draft in western Pennsylvania. The general soon came with that list. He inquired if there were any difference in the charges or degrees of guilt. The general replied that he knew of none. "Well," said he, "these fellows have suffered long enough, and I have thought so for some time. And now that my mind is on it, I believe I will turn out the flock. So draw up the order, General, and let me sign it." It was done, and the general left the room. Turning then to these women, Lincoln said, "Now, ladies, you can go." The young woman ran forward and was about to kneel in thankfulness. "Get up," said he. "Don't kneel to me. Thank God and go." The old woman came forward with tears in her eyes to say goodbye. "Goodbye," said she, "Mr. Lincoln. I shall never see you again until we meet in heaven." She had the president's hand in hers. He instantly took her right hand in both of his and, following her to the door, and said, "I'm afraid with all my troubles I shall never get there. But if I do, I will find you. That you wish me to get to heaven is the best wish you could make for me. Goodbye." We were alone. I said to him, "Lincoln, with my knowledge of your nervous sensibility, it's a wonder that such scenes as this don't kill you." "I am," said he, "very unwell. My feet and my hands are always cold. I suppose I ought to be in bed. But things of that sort don't hurt me. For to tell you the truth, that scene which you witnessed is the only thing I've done today that's given me any pleasure. I have in it made two people happy. That old lady was no counterfeit. The mother spoke out in all the features of her face. It is more than we can often say that in doing right, we have made two people happy in one day. Quote, speed die when I may want, it said of me by those who know me best, that I always plucked a thistle and planted a flower where I thought a flower would grow. Such is the recital of the interview, you ask. The finishing touch to a portrait by Wilson was given just after this interview. John Williams has a copy of it. There are some traits of character for which Lincoln was peculiar above all the men I've ever known. He never forgot anything, especially any kind of any personal kindness. As an instance of this, when he was in Kentucky in 1841, he was moody and a hypochondriac. He was staying at the house of my mother. She observed him, and one morning when they were alone, presented him with a Bible. Years rolled round and he was president. The old lady sent word that she wanted his photograph. He sent it with this sentence, "To my very good friend, Mrs. Lucy G. Speed, who gave me an Oxford Bible 20 years ago. A. Lincoln." This little told tale of Abraham Lincoln's heart and faith makes me sense of depth of face in a more often tale from the Civil War. It has been said by many people that one day one of President Lincoln's advisors made a comment about God being on the side of the Union. To which Lincoln responded, "Sir, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side, for God is always right." Now, if you're going to preach on that and you do some research, you're going to find out that there's a whole lot of debate over whether or not Lincoln uttered that last phrase. But we know for a fact in his second inaugural address, which is carved into stone at the Lincoln Memorial, that when he talked of this divided populace, he said, "Both read the same Bible and pray to the same God, and each invokes his aid against the other. The prayers of both could not be answered. That of neither has been answered fully." Like a zealot and a tax collector, like what you and I know very well about a northerner and a southerner, the gathering of people called the Church of Jesus Christ is not primarily concerned with our own opinions. It's concerned with focusing on knowing and serving the same Lord and God. Now that reminds me of a couple of conversations that I had personally about 20 years ago in this church. Not long after we started our Saturday soup kitchen, I heard the same sentiment expressed by two different people in our congregation a couple of months apart. They had each been early supporters of our Saturday soup kitchen, and they'd shown up on several occasions where I had the opportunity to work together. Now, each of them, independently at different times, came up and told me how much they had really grown to appreciate and love this other person. Now, being in my position, it made me smile, and thankfully not laugh, because I'd come to know each of those people separately over years of ministry from different encounters. And I was pretty sure that one of them, a dear person in our church, was about as far to the right as you can get on the political spectrum, while the other dear soul leaned hard left. I smiled because I couldn't imagine having a gathering here at the church where we talked politics or theology, where I could have gotten those two people to agree on anything. And they're both still in the congregation, and I still feel that way about them. But when it came to following the Lord that they each loved by working side by side, serving hungry people in the name of Jesus Christ at a soup kitchen, these two had come to respect and admire and love one another. Jesus showed us how to do that in his church, because when he got the first 12 together, one was a zealot and one was a tax collector. We reflect that understanding in the questions that we ask of everybody who decides to join this particular church. These are the membership questions. Is Jesus Christ your Lord and your Savior? Do you trust in him? And do you intend to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love? That's it. That's all we ask when we join the church. And if today we all still say yes to those questions, then lots of the other things don't really matter in this gathering called the Church of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I invite you now to join us in a closing hymn. It's number 353, "My Hope is Built on Nothing Less." Please stand if you're physically able.
Jesus' blood and righteousness.
We can learn a lot from looking at that combination of people that Jesus called to be his disciples. In the next week, we're going to have to look at faithfulness and denial, which is also a part of our walk in many ways. But again, we're going to focus back on Jesus, who calls us, who claims us, who loves us, and who won't let us go. Friends, that's the thing that brings us together. We are Christians, followers of Jesus Christ. Keep that at your heart as you go out and invite others to follow that same Lord. And as you do, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with all of us now and forevermore. Amen. Before we let Jeremy play and before we go away, let's have a blessing over our meal. So let's bow before God. God, we thank you for the hands that are busy now preparing the soups, the salads, the breads for our lunch. We thank you for all those who generously give of their time so we can come and sit at table in fellowship with other believers. We ask you to bless that food, bless the fellowship that follows now, and bless us in Christ's precious name. Amen.